Good evening. I'd like to call the regular, excuse me, I've got a cough and I'm choking down cough drops. Good evening. I'd like to call the regular Village Board meeting for December 17th, 2018 to order and ask Clerk Brondike to call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Here.
Trustee Carballo.
Here.
Trustee Quitzel.
Here.
Trustee Dixit.
Here.
Trustee Hasse.
Here.
Trustee Mandel absent. Mayor Pisak.
Here. And at this time, I'd like to ask everybody to stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And we'll start tonight's meeting with appointments, proclamations, and presentations. And the first item on our agenda is a proclamation for the Lisle Lions football team. Before reading the proclamation, I'd like to invite Coach Paul Parpett, his coaching staff, and members of the 2018 Lisle High School Lions football team to the podium. Please gather around. Wow, what a line. So, whereas the Lisle Lions football team demonstrated outstanding efforts and teamwork during the 2018 season, and whereas as Interstate 8 conference champions, the Lisle Lions headed to the Class 3A quarterfinals for the first time since 1985, and whereas the village acknowledges these achievements, which includes an impressive final record of 10-2 for the season, and whereas I present this proclamation to Paul Parpett, head coach, assistant coaches, and members of the 2018 Lisle Lions football team for their successful season, and now, therefore, be it resolved that I, Christopher R. Pisak, mayor of the village of Lisle, do hereby proclaim and offer congratulations to the Lisle Lions football coaches, players, and the entire Lisle Lions football community. What a great season, guys. It was great to watch.
This is when it's kind of awkward because they, you know, like you're here.
Coach, I'm sorry, if you'd like to come up and say a few words at the podium, you're welcome to. speak into the microphones there at the podium.
At the beginning of the season, our young men kind of had an inclination that they could have a successful season. And if we stayed healthy, which we did, played with a great competitive spirit, and they played for each other. I think one of the things that's lost in today's athletics is a true meaning of a teammate. I think there's so many individuals out there today that think about individual things, but the backbone of a team is being great teammates. Whether you're out there for the whole 48 minutes or you're out there for 3 minutes, being a teammate is essential to team success. And we had 30 players that I firmly believe were outstanding teammates. And that propelled us in a lot of tough times because not every game was easy, but I think that they did an outstanding job. On the other note of this is not only are these young men outstanding in athletic competition, almost 99% of them are also outstanding academically, which is another thing that we really stress at Lisle Senior High School. Lisle Senior High School is an outstanding place. And I've been at other places and I really enjoy it. I enjoy the parents, I enjoy the players, I enjoy the administration. It's a good place. Lisle is a good place. And we really thank you for having us here tonight. It's an honor it's an honor to be, to represent Lisle Senior High School. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Coach.
Is Raptors getting an award?
That's pizza, man.
Okay, thanks, guys.
Next on our agenda, we have here with us today Illinois State Representative-elect Ann Stava Murray from the 81st District. I'd like to introduce Ann. Please come up to the podium. Lisle's Illinois State Representative. Would you like to say a few words?
Yes, thank you. So my name is Ann Stava Murray, the 81st District. Most people are confused about state districts. So I represent just a tiny corner of Lisle, but it was important for me to come here today to introduce myself to all of you, because although I'm just technically only a little bit of you can vote for me, I want to be teammates, to echo the sentiment before, of every citizen that's nearby. And I think that you being across the street from my district, these districts can change, as we know. So I want to make sure that I'm taking into account everyone who lives nearby. And so if you find you're knocking on the door of your state rep and it's not me, but you feel like you haven't been heard, I always have an open door. I'm looking for the door right now. So my state rep office, my district covers a little corner of Lisle. My largest portion is in Downers Grove, a little bit of Naperville, and a strip of people in between. And it's very interestingly shaped, as all are. But I grew up in the area about 10 minutes from here. I went to Bennett. I ran cross country, so I ran through a lot of your amazing streets of Lisle, and it's important to me that we are working together and that I'm taking into account the needs of people. And so I had taken no money from my party to run, and I feel like what people need and who people are and how I can best support them is definitely what's most important to me. And so I want everyone to know that, whether I'm your rep or not, and please reach out. I love to hear from people and love to hear people's concerns. And anything that happens at a state level, you have an ear with me. So thank you so much.
Thank you. And as we move on to public hearing and public comment, are there any members of the public present that would like to make comments regarding non-agenda items? If so, please feel free to come down to the podium. Members of the public that would like to speak about an agenda item will have the opportunity to do so at the time the item is called for consideration. Please state your name for the record and go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Autumn Geis-Lombardo. I am a Lisle resident and business owner. I'm not able to stay very long this evening. I'm getting over a little cold myself, so I hope you feel better. I just wanted to mention to you, as a year and a half old business owner, I see a great value in the organization of the Lisle Visitor and Convention Bureau. They've been very supportive to us as a small business and really helped to draw a lot of attention and build a lot of interest in our small business. And so I just wanted to state, as a business owner, the value that I see in the organization and its value for all of Lisle businesses. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We will have this at the Committee of the Whole. I don't believe it's on an agenda item for this Village Board meeting, but it'll be later in the evening.
Hi, my name is Wayne Dunham, and I'm the organizer of the Lisle Santa Train, which this year celebrated its silver anniversary, 25 years of...
Mr. Dunham, would you pull the microphones a little closer?
That's true. Autumn's a little smaller than I am, isn't she? Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so I wanted to come before the Village Board and thank you and all of the other parts of the village who have worked with us for these 25 years to make the train successful. It's simply something that... you can't do without the help of the people that run the community you live in. I learned that 25 years ago when I was the head of the Eyes of the Sky Committee, and we had to work with everyone from the road committee to the police, the fire department, because it was such a massive project in the park district, and everybody pitched together and made it the success that it has been and that it has become. So 25 years ago, when the Lisle Convention and Visitors Bureau brought a group of us and to create a series of events to mark the beginning of the holiday season in Lisle. We were adamant about the need for us all to continue to work together with the various village groups that work on these kinds of things and are happy to volunteer. And because of the village's involvement with us, the police helping to park all the cars from people who don't know that the south lot is a small lot and the north lot is the big lot, we were able to succeed. Also, the park district did great things for us, including now they even pay for a reindeer for 2 hours on a Sunday so that after the train ride, people can go over and visit with them. So it's really nice, and it really blends in well with the Once Upon a Christmas celebration that the Lisle Heritage Society does. So it's just been a great, great thing. So we now lease an 11-car Metra commuter train, and this year, on our silver anniversary, we took our 50,000th person to the North Pole and back, Chicago. So we're very proud of that fact. We do 2,000 a year by contract. They limit us to that many. We normally can fit more in, but they don't want us to do that because it gets pretty crowded. So of all the groups, the organization I'd especially like to recognize is the Lisle Convention and Tourism Bureau because of the instrumental part they have in making this event a success. Each year they field literally hundreds of phone calls about the trains, and without their help, our train, I think, would simply disappear. I still work for a living, and so do most of our volunteers, so we couldn't possibly handle all of the phone calls by ourselves or with a tape recorder and try to return them at night when we come home from work. But they actually, joyously, from what people have told me who have called in, talk to them about the train and what it does and the various places they can go afterwards for lunch or for breakfast before the train and all the different things that are going on in the community. And it's really been wonderful for us. And one of the big things they do is to get publicity. I don't know, probably most of you saw the big full-page article that appeared in the Daily Herald that Diane Homolka wrote, but it's about the whole Santa parade, you know, the train, the whole Once Upon a Christmas celebration, and that even in an area, in a time period when a lot of people don't read newspapers anymore, is an immense event for us. So I want to conclude by thanking the village and the Park District and the Lisle Heritage Society and all of the wonderful support groups that have helped us make the train succeed over these 25 years. I'd like to acknowledge also the Lisle Area Girl Scouts, who serve as the elves on each of our trains, and also the Lisle Teens with Character, who have helped out and make it work very successfully for us. We couldn't run the train for year after year, and we couldn't have the enjoyment that we get for doing it without all of you working together. So, thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay, we'll move on to meeting minutes. May I have a motion to approve meeting minutes for the Village Board Committee of the Whole meeting November 19th and Village Board regular meeting December 3rd, 2018?
I move to approve the meeting minutes as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Moving on to the voucher list, approval of Village of Lisle voucher list of December 17th, 2018 for $1,184,487.36. May I have a motion?
I move to approve the voucher list as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, any public comment? Hearing none, Clerk Brondike, please call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Dixit.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye, and the motion passes. Moving on to our consent agenda, all items on the consent agenda are considered routine by the Village Board and will be acted on as a group. These items will not be separately discussed unless a Village Board member so requests, in which event the item will be removed from the consent agenda and considered separately. I'd like to ask Village Manager Ertmo to provide an overview of each of the items.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Good evening, everyone. Item A on the consent agenda is a resolution approving the execution of a three-year renewal of the Microsoft Enterprise Agreement with CDWG for our Microsoft Office licensing here at the Village. This is for upgrades and support in an amount not to exceed $84,339.36. Item B is a resolution authorizing a contract for work associated with a water system backup, emergency backup generators in an amount not to exceed $324,812. Approval of this item will authorize the Village to contract for the installation of emergency backup generators at each of our four rate control stations that are a part of the Village's water system. Item C is a resolution authorizing a professional services contract for construction-related engineering services associated with the water system emergency backup project to Strand and Associates in an amount not to exceed $18,000. Item D and E are both acknowledgments and informational on our financial reports. Item D is for September 30th, and item E is the report as of October 31st in 2018. Item F is a resolution authorizing a purchase order to ESRA of Redlands, California for our GIS software, the license and maintenance in an amount not to exceed $11,700. Again, this is software and GIS mapping software and licenses that our shared service partner over at DuPage County uses to provide our mapping system. Final item is item G, and it's a resolution authorizing an amendment to the personnel manual regarding on-call compensation. As the board will recall, for the Local 150 contract, the board approved increasing the on-call rate from 4 to 6 hours of straight time per week for unionized public works employees. This will match that for the non-union public works employees. That concludes my report, unless there's questions.
Thank you. At this time, would any trustee like any items to be considered separately? Seeing none, any public comment? Seeing none, may I have a motion?
I move to approve the consent agenda items A through G.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Clerk Brondyk, please call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Dixit.
Aye.
Mayor Pisak.
Aye. And the motion passes. Moving on to our regular agenda, first is an ordinance amending Title IX, Chapter 2 and 3 of the Village of Lisle Code. Approval of this ordinance will allow the Village to more clearly define animal control regulations and animal owner responsibilities in the Village. Would Director Smetana please provide an overview of this item?
Yes, thank you. Good evening, Mayor, members of the board. As the Mayor stated, the ordinance before you tonight contains amendments to Chapters 2 and 3 of Title IX. These amendments have been prepared by Village staff and the Village attorney, and they better clarify existing provisions related to the Village's animal control practices and pet owner responsibilities. The amendments also remove any provisions that were duplicative to the Illinois Animal Control Act and Humane Care for Animals Act. In keeping with the direction provided by the Committee of the Whole on December 3rd, the ordinance before you tonight does not contain provisions that would authorize the keeping of chickens within the Village of Lisle. With that, staff is recommending approval of the proposed ordinance amending Title IX, Chapters 2 and 3 of the Lisle Village Code.
Thank you. Is there any public comment? Seeing none, may I have a motion?
I move to approve an ordinance amending Title IX, Chapter 2 and 3 of the Lisle Village Code as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any board discussion? Seeing none, Clerk Brondyk, please call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Dixit.
Aye.
And the motion passes. Next on our agenda is a resolution amending the compensation plan to retitle the Deputy Village Clerk, Business Office Manager, Business Office Assistant, Development Services Assistant positions, add a Permits and Licensing Coordinator position, assign related salary grades to new positions, and adjust rates of pay for customer service representatives. Would staff please provide an overview of this item?
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Just real quickly, this is an initiative, again, to better serve, to enhance productivity, reduce overall personnel costs, and really provide better and more efficient customer service to the community. And with that, I'll turn it over to Assistant Manager Knight to go through the details with the board.
Good evening, Mayor and Board. The resolution that you have before you is an effort that stems from some of the initiatives that Manager Ermode had mentioned. It's also related to some pending retirements. So we have a pending retirement in business office, as well as one that just recently occurred at the beginning of the month. As is our practice, when these pending retirements are made known, a thorough review of current job responsibilities and practices occurred. The results of this analysis included the identification of some opportunities to improve application processing, coverage, and transaction processing. The proposed reclassification of the positions in the business office and development services department, reassignment of a deputy village clerk, and creation of a permits and licensing coordinator are key steps of this plan in accomplishing these goals. And with approval of this item, staff will move to create a customer service center as we enter into the new year, with training to occur over the course of the following weeks. The deputy village clerk will assist with this training before being relocated to the village manager's office to continue clerk's duties and have an expanded role in village communication efforts. One of the last steps will be to recruit, hire, and train a permit and licensing coordinator. The goal of hiring for this position will be to provide efficient, clear, accurate, and expedient service to those seeking permit and licenses. This single point of contact is expected to be help both with meeting customer expectations and needs, as well as improving internal processing. Meetings have taken place with the affected employees, where the timeline for these changes and questions regarding the process have been discussed. Overall, while it is difficult to say goodbye to long-tenured employees, staff is looking forward to the challenge of providing improved service to residents and other users of the front desk. That concludes my report, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. Is there any public comment? Seeing none, may I have a motion?
I move to approve a resolution amending the compensation plan to retitle the Deputy Village Clerk, Business Office Manager, Business Office Assistant, and Development Service Assistant positions, add a Permits and Licensing Coordinator position, assign related salary grades to new positions, and adjust rates of pay for customer service representatives as presented.
We have a motion and a second.
I just had one question. I'm remembering right, this is where it's also a move to change the office hours to 4:30 rather than 5, or is that?
Correct, that'd be part of the changes that we're putting in place.
I just had one question, which is, what kind of analysis did you do to make sure that that isn't inconveniencing people not having that half hour close to, I'm thinking of people getting off work and trying to get to the business office before it closes?
Sure, so it was actually a combination of years of anecdotal experience, but also in addition to several more recent months where that 4:30 to 5 o'clock time slot was tracked. We've actually recorded a number of people that have come into Village Hall and have found that it was really low. So that was part of the adjustment.
Any other board questions? Hearing none, Clerk Brandeis, please call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Dixit.
Aye.
And the motion passes. Moving on to officials and staff reports, I'd like to start off the elected officials reports this evening with a just making a statement that several meetings ago I asked for Marquette, representatives of Marquette and Kinsey to come join us at a meeting and have a discussion about schedule. They since responded with a revised schedule, and then they also responded with a video that's more of a commercial rather than answering questions about schedule. So I'll let them post their video for marketing purposes on their own website rather than taking our time here, where it doesn't address any questions on schedule. The number one question I get asked around town is what is the schedule for completing the Marquette project? And I'd really like for Mr. Ryan or representatives of Marquette to come to the board meeting and have a conversation with us, but the best I can surmise from the last schedule that we've been presented, which was in June of 2017, that given the task, which was pouring the topping on the floors, if that was done today, a year ago, they would still need till July of the following year to complete their project. So the best I can surmise for their schedule is that it'll be at least 7 or 8 more months. But if they can join us here at a meeting and demonstrate to us that that they can do it quicker, I'm all ears. I'm eager to hear how quickly they can get it done. So that said, that completes my official's report. Any other? I'll start around the dais. Trustee
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
Okay.
Nothing other than hope everyone has a safe and nice holiday, and Happy New Year to everyone.
Trustee Carvalho.
Same here for me. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to everybody.
And Trustee Hesse?
Nothing tonight, thank you.
Trustee Quetzal?
No, thank you.
Okay, any staff reports this evening?
Mayor, just one. I'd like to ask Public Works Director Elias just to provide a recap of our 2018 Village Leaf Collection Program.
Excellent, thank you.
Director Elias.
Thank you. So the Village Operated Leaf Program was planned for 5 weeks of leaf collection between the weeks of Monday, October 29th, and Monday, November 26th. This year's program was conducted 2 weeks later than past years in response to public input, which requested the program start later in the season to facilitate collection of leaves that fall late in the season. Prior to making the shift in the schedule, it was made clear that there was a possibility of ending the program early in the event of a snowstorm. Public Works performed 4 weeks of leaf collection. However, the program ended 1 week early due to a snowstorm, which occurred on Sunday, November 25th and Monday, November 26th. During the 4 weeks of collection, we collected approximately 4,200 cubic yards of leaves. For perspective, the program has averaged approximately 5,200 cubic yards of leaves over the past 5 years. After the Village's program ended, Lakeshore Recycling Systems conducted 2 weeks of bag pickup. The first week did not require a yard waste sticker for collection. At this point, that is the current status of the leaf program. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
And Mayor, just real quickly, I just wanted to add, as you know, again, we responded this past year as an adjustment in order to improve customer service and be responsive to residents' concerned. Where the Village is committed to continual improvement and continue looking at the program to see what we can do differently and better serve the community. And we've already started discussions with Lakeshore that, you know, should this happen again, the unforeseen weather, you know, what would it take for, given that our resources are tied up with snow removal, what would it take for them to hook on to our trailers and perform the loose leaf pickup after the snow had melted? So these are all items we're looking at in order to make a part of the proposed budget process, bring back to the board for further discussion to make sure we're continually evaluating, continue to refine, and continue to better the program for the community.
Thank you. Is there any option for a spring cleanup at all? Or would that have to be budgeted for?
We can certainly budget for that. Depends on what that would entail. Right now, I know the Public Works Department does a spring brush collection. If we wanted to see how much a spring bagged collection would be with Lakeshore, that's something we could definitely explore. It's something we'll probably have to decide sooner rather than later, let people know. But that's something as we go through the proposed revised budget process, we can get a quote. So just we had this with the Lakeshore pickup on December 5th. They picked up eight truckloads, and just to give the board an idea, again, that was around a little north of $6,000 to complete that pickup. So that's something we can reach back to Lakeshore and see what a spring cleanup like that would be. Again, it would be based on volume, how much is out there, how much people set up, so it'd be a little bit of a moving target to get a firm price, but that's something we can explore with them in the first spring pickup if that's board direction.
Okay, thank you. Any other board or officials questions regarding that report?
Yes, please. I would just like to thank Public Works for their Herculean efforts in getting the leaves picked up and the responsiveness of shifting based on experience last year. I have had, in all candor, I have had people approach me about not having that opportunity for the last pickup without bags. I have had constituents who are very upset about that, and I'm just hoping that in the I wish there were a way, I guess, that we could be a little bit more nimble and perhaps, like in this circumstance, I guess in a perfect world after the snow came and was dealt with, if even one truck was put back. And I sit here saying that, not being in public works and not knowing all that that entails, I'm sure far more than I would ever be able to think of. But again, not in any way to detract from what truly is a Herculean effort by everyone to get that taken care of and get all that snow, that early snow, taken care of, but just a hope that we could be more nimble, however that might be. So thank you.
And I have one quick question and comment. I do think, and thank you, Public Works, for making our streets safe. And removal of snow is the utmost importance. I know that it has been a very big inconvenience to have all of the leaves, but can you let us know how long it would take for a truck to be converted and what it would mean just logistically so that everyone understands that logistic piece?
Sure. So to address the nimbleness question, I guess just briefly, I won't go into a lot of detail, but this past snowstorm was about 8 inches of wet heavy snow that fell on Sunday night into Monday. It generated, I don't have the exact number, but it generated more phone calls than any snowstorm I can recall in the past 10 years, except for maybe the blizzard of 2011. So we were busy essentially the entire week just on follow-up, on inspections, and also just in terms of some of the staffing issues and as far as being nimble and turning things around. You have to remember, too, that we break into two shifts. So our night shift wasn't actually back into the office during the day until, I believe it was Wednesday. So that shortens their week for them in terms of being even having enough staff to do any sort of equipment conversion and things like that, because we still have our other duties that we have to do regarding our water system and streetlight maintenance and things like that. So without getting too detailed, it is hard to be nimble, admittedly. I understand the situation that people were put in terms of raking, you know, their leaves out to the curb after we did our fourth pickup. We made the decision on Saturday to do the conversion because the weather monitoring system we use, up until Saturday morning, they were still kind of flip-flopping on what the severity of that storm was going to be. And so we didn't want to make the call too early to switch to leaf machines and then have that storm all go south of us, and then it'd be sunny skies on Monday, and then we're saying, sorry, we converted our equipment, we're not picking up. So we had to kind of balance the ability to do both programs, and that's one of the challenges we have with weather situations and with our other responsibilities, to be nimble. Unfortunately, we've got limitations to our program. They've been kind of exposed these last 2 years with the late leaf drop last year and then with the early snowstorm this year. So really, you know, the ways I could see as far as solving those problems would be to have if we had a bag pickup, if we went back to our original schedule, that has always been after we finished the week before Thanksgiving, we would have the ability for bags to be placed out the following 2 weeks. Well, what that does, the major complaints we received were, you know, the leaves are going to make a mess. You're not picking up my leaves. They're going to make a mess, and they're going to cover the storm drains. Well, if people knew that they could bag them, they wouldn't have raked them out to the curb. So there would be no potential for clogging storm drains, and they wouldn't be a mess in the parkway, so to speak. So that would be one potential solution. The other solution would possibly be to transition to a full 100% bag program, because then people aren't raking to the curb. Unfortunately, anytime you're raking to the curb or to the street side, we're kind of at the mercy of a snowstorm that comes up late in the season, and we're left with what we've got now. To answer Trustee Dixit's question about timing, for conversion, it takes us that that Saturday and Sunday, it takes about a day, a full day, for the crews to convert the plows to, you know, to convert the leaf machine trucks to plows, to put the plows on, spreader them, dial them in, test them, and that's assuming nothing goes wrong. And, you know, luckily we were able to do that this year, but, you know, they're not simple machines. There's a lot of hydraulics involved, things like that. So it takes about a day to convert. If we were to convert even one machine or one truck to go back out and do leaf, that truck, I'm estimating it would probably take close to a week to go through the entire village to find other leaves to go back and pick up. So now you're talking about a day before, about a week to pick up to, because we have no way of tracking who put leaves out, so we have to canvass the entire village, about a week of that canvassing, and then another day on the back end to convert back to snowplows. So, you know, given the way Chicago weather is, I'm not comfortable taking a snowplow out of service for a week at a time, you know, to go back and pick up leaves. And that's the main reason why we didn't transition back to, and that's just a single leaf machine. If we do all three leaf machines, it just kind of compounds the problem should we get that unanticipated snowfall. Luckily we haven't this year, and it's kind of hard, you know, it's kind of, you know, hindsight's 2020, but you know, there's been cases where we've gotten snows where they weren't predicted, you know, 3-4 days in advance, and we've had to be able to respond. So we put a priority on snow response at this time of year, and that's kind of why the decision was made the way it was.
So the major complaint that I heard from people was on Sunday. They were unaware still that they had to go pick up those leaves, and the snow really didn't start till like late Sunday afternoon. Is there some way that we could have notified the residents any sooner? People referred to what Naperville does. They have Naper Notify. They all get phone calls. So they knew to get out there before it started to snow and get those leaves in bags. That's what I did. I was scrambling Saturday night getting my leaves into bags. But is there some way that we could have notified the residents any sooner before the snow actually hit? Because I think that was the major issue, is by the time they realized it was starting to rain, the snow was starting, and nobody could pick up those wet leaves and put them in bags. They were afraid the bags were going to fall apart. That's my main thing. Is there some way we could let people know sooner?
And I'll piggyback on that before, so you can answer both. The other thing that just comes to mind, again, to someone who hasn't had to actually go do this, is could we have a contingency with an outsource provider? I was talking to an alderman in Geneva. They fully outsource leaf collection to Kramer. Just questioning if that's a viable.
Sure. So the question as far as outsourcing is, you know, you mentioned Kramer Tree, who does it for the city of Geneva. Those contractors are few and far between, and they are under contract with the city of Geneva, so they don't have the resources to attend to Geneva before they attend to Lyle, I guess. So it's tough to get an operation like that on board at the spur of the moment. And in reality, you know, again, it didn't happen this time, but it could, where the time it would take us to even contract with a Kramer, assuming that they had availability, contract with them, have them mobilize, get out, get through town, and do a pickup, you're talking probably, you know, close to a week, week and a half, maybe 2 weeks by the time that all happens. You could potentially have another snowstorm in that time. So it's I understand the desire to do that. Sometimes it's easier said than done, I suppose. As far as communicating to the residents earlier on Saturday, you know, this time around we did use our communication channels. You know, could we have improved the process with those communication channels? We can certainly look into that and learn from this experience and try and improve, you know, in the future. This was a little bit of a scramble for us too, because it's the first time we've had to experience something like this with the shifting of the schedule. So we can certainly look to improve that aspect of the program in the future.
And I think Public Works did a great job, but if I can elaborate on your question, Trustee Quetzal, I think there may have been two parts to your question. Can we contract out an emergency pickup versus contracting out the entire program? And I think contracting out the entire program was asked in the past, but there'd have to be some financial givebacks. We have staff available to do the pickups when they're idle. to contract somebody else out would require additional funds.
My current question wasn't about contracting out the whole thing. It was just if it would be possible to have that be an emergency backup option.
Okay.
And just to answer Trustee Quitzel's comment, we are talking to Lakeshore about that. So our Lakeshore contacts have met with Director Elias and his team, and they're looking at options, and we'll provide a proposal, and we will bring that forward to the board as part of the budgeting process as well.
But that would be bagged, though?
No, they would. Right now, what we're talking about is the possibility of them using our LEAF equipment.
With their trucks and their employees, they would use our vacuum machines.
Because I've been thinking, you know, because again, I really took some flack on this, and I did talk to the manager a little bit about this. The reality is there are, for whatever reasons, there are some, and I don't know, I haven't driven all around the village, but in the places I've been, there are some pretty substantive piles out there that, for whatever reason, didn't get picked up, and I just, that's a very visual reminder for now 3 or 4 long months that something didn't, you know, inadvertently didn't go right. And I hope I'm not coming across like I'm trying to beat up on Public Works. I am absolutely not.
I understand completely.
You did a great job. I'm just trying to be understanding of constituents.
Your point is well taken. And so I see the same things you see.
I guess where I was going with that is if something could be worked out with Lakeshore, even if we didn't have to wait until March or April, if depending on how the weather is. Just throwing that out there.
I agree also. There was a lot of complaints on this issue. I agree with Trustee Quitzel. One other thing that I was thinking might be worth looking into is if we have the equipment, instead of changing trucks over, maybe it might be possible to use our LEAF equipment with our staff, but also rent a truck or borrow a truck. I don't know if we could borrow trucks from any of the other, from the park district or whatever, or rent them from a place and use our staff to pick up the leaves when it's not snowing, like, you know, after this last snowstorm. So,
and like, and maybe it wouldn't have to be that. I'm going to make a confession. I had a constituent who was so mad. To me, why have an angry constituent with an easy fix? I lined my trunk in plastic. I went over, picked up his leaves, and put them on my compost pile. No, I'm not offering to do that for anybody else. I'm just saying it really is something I hate to have people be upset about.
Do we have any new trucks coming this year?
Not this fiscal year, no.
What
not,
do we usually,
not of the size that are needed to...
What do we usually get for the old ones when we finally sell them out?
Tough question. It depends on their condition and age. I don't know offhand.
Where I'm going is, you know, that old clunker that you park behind the garage that you can't get started. Do you keep one of those in reserve to use and when needed?
That's another option we're currently looking at. I will say, just for information, one of the ones we do have two trucks, I believe, for next year's budget for replacement, so we're looking at the possibility of utilizing those old trucks.
A new potentially truck is, mounting, a new truck is right around 100,000, right?
No, it's north of that now.
North of that,
yeah,
no?
It's more like 180, 190.
Okay, wow.
So it's not a cheap proposition, but just you know, one of the trucks that we are scheduled to replace next year just had a water pump failure. You know, so it's one of those things where you don't want to hold on to things where you're constantly pouring maintenance into something, especially something that's going to be used for 5 weeks a year. But that being said, it's something that we can certainly look at and see if it's possible to either mount our LEAF machines onto those trucks instead of having to tow the trucks, and then we roll the dice that those trucks are going to last us those 5 weeks a year. They're not used all year long, you know, so that's a possibility as well. It's just, you know, we are looking at other options for the program.
Good.
Okay. Any other staff reports this evening?
Nothing. I just want to be clear. Is there direction to look at an alternative for picking up the remaining leaves out there? I mean, because if that's the case, we'd have to go to Kramer or another landscape company to see if they're available in order to go through town and pick those.
The township did it after the snowstorm, so their equipment might be available.
Okay. I personally would see if we can find something before the next board meeting, find some option. I think we'd all be willing to consider it and see if we can give approval to go ahead with it.
Okay, we'll bring something back for the next meeting.
Thank you. Any other staff reports? Hearing none? No, sorry? Good. Okay, hearing none, may I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Clerk Brondike, please call the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hasse.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Quitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Dixit.
Aye.
And we are adjourned. Please bear with us. We're going to change the tape and get ready for our Village Board Committee of the Whole meeting here in about 5 minutes.